So good afternoon to all. I welcome you all to the lecture of by Professor P. Gopinath for the Virendranath Multimedical Award. So now organized by DORA with Department of Biotechnology. So I welcome you all during the lecture. Have a small note. After the lecture, we have a discussion session. So I request all the participants who have the questions, please write down in the chat box. So I will note it down and I will read the questions on behalf of you, and Professor Gopinath will answer the questions. So now I welcome the head of the Department of Biotechnology, Professor Ashwini Sharma, to please introduce Professor Gopinath and start the event.
So it is my immense pleasure and honor to welcome you all to the talk by Professor Gopinath, who is recipient of Virendranath Malti Mittal Award. Professor Gopinath has been in our department as an associate professor, and he works in the area of nanobiotechnology. This ceremony was supposed to be completed in March 2020, but due to this particular problem, prevailing situation, this has been delayed. His topic of talk would be 4D scaffolds adding a new dimension to tissue engineering. I welcome you all, and I would request Professor Gopinath to deliver his lecture, and this will be followed by the award ceremony. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Sharma and Professor Krishna Mohan, and also Professor Gurjas sir. And I hope my voice is audible. Yeah, so very good evening to all of you. And today I'll be giving a talk on 4D scaffolds, adding a new dimension to tissue engineering as a part of the VNM award. And my lecture will be very simple for the broad audience. In my lecture, I'll be talking about first what is tissue engineering, and followed by what is the role of nanotechnology in the tissue engineering. And I'll briefly talk about the how we developed the 4D scaffold and what are these various applications. And also I'll be talking about various other technologies which we developed in our lab at IIT Roorkee. So before we learn about what is tissue engineering, let us see a simple statistics like what is the need for the organs today? If you see the statistics in the US, alone, approximately 119,000 people need the organ transplantation. Okay, so every year people are suffering due to organ damage, and every day at least 22 people are dying due to lack of suitable organ. Okay, if in US alone, 22 people are dying every day, then you can think about the whole world, how many people are dying every day due to lack of suitable organ. And if you see the statistics in India, almost 1.5 lakh people in India need a kidney. But out of that, only 3,000 people are able to receive the kidney. And 90% of the people in the waiting list are dying without getting the organ. So the main problem is we don't get the sufficient donors. And even if you get the sufficient donors, that particular organ should match to your body. That is a major problem. And if you see the liver transplantation, approximately we need 25,000 liver transplantation, but only 800 is able to manage. We are able to manage only 800 liver transplantation. And out of that 800 also, 70% of liver transplantation is mainly by the live donor, and the remaining 30% from the cadaver, that is the brain dead people. So this is the statistics. So once we lose the organ, so it is very difficult to get back. So then we have to mainly depend on the organ transplantation, or we have to come up with some new technology to replace the damaged or the repaired organ. So if I ask you the cost of your mobile phone, or if I ask you the cost of your watch, you can easily tell the cost of your mobile phone. But if I ask you the cost of your liver, or if I ask you the cost of the lungs, that is, we don't know the price, or we don't really know the value of the organ, unless until we have the organ functional. So if the organ goes bad, if the organ is not functional, or if it is damaged, then you realize the real value of the each and every organ. So you can see here, according to this website, the cost of each organ, you can see how much cost each organ is. Okay, so that's why, like, if the organ is damaged, then we have to wait for the organ donation. That is why, or we are dependent on the new technology such as tissue engineering or the organ printing. So let us see what is tissue engineering. It is a multidisciplinary field, and it is a combination of biotechnology as well as other engineering field like electrical engineering, metallurgy, mechanical. So we need the help from the all the engineering departments to make the artificial tissues or the artificial organ. So why we need tissue engineering? Because we want to replace the diseased or the damaged tissue, and because the donor tissues and organs are in short in supply. So we don't have sufficient donors. So that is a major problem. And we want to minimize the immune system response. For example, we cannot take organ from anybody. So even if the donor is ready to donate the organ, that organ should match with our body. So that is a major problem in case of organ transplantation. So we want to minimize the immune system response. So how we can minimize the immune system response? By taking the patient's own cell, and we can grow in the lab. So that is the overall idea of the tissue engineering. For example, if you want to suppose a person is suffering from some disease and he needs the organ transplantation, what we can do is we can take the patient's own cell and we can put it on the polymer scaffold. So here the scaffold means support. For example, for constructing a building, you need the foundation. On the foundation, you can build that 10-story building, or you can build that 20-story building or complex, whatever you want, you can make it. So the polymer scaffold is like your foundation. On the support, you can add the patient's cell, and the patient's cells will grow on the scaffold, and it can regrow as a complete tissue, and the complete tissue can be re-implanted into the patient body. And okay, so this is an overview of the tissue engineering. So the first step is we can take the healthy cells from the patient's body, and we can grow the cells in the lab condition so that the cells we can grow in more numbers. So once you grow the cells in more numbers, then you can add the cells on the three-dimensional scaffold. So once you add it on the scaffold, so the cells will grow on the scaffold. Scaffold, as I told you, this is a, like a support. So once the cells grow on the scaffold, and you can re-implant the engineered tissue in the lab to the patient body. So this is the overview of tissue engineering. So why we need three-dimensional scaffold? Usually we grow the cells in the lab in the two-dimensional, this kind of glass plates or the plastic plates. So when you grow the cells in these plastic plates, it is not going to mimic the original organ, because inside our body, we have all the organs are three-dimensional. Okay, so we have the three-dimensional environment. So to mimic our original tissue or the original organ, we need the three-dimensional scaffold. So what are the three important tools required for the tissue engineering? The first thing is the cells. Okay, so the cells, it can be a stem cell or the progenitor cells. So we can, the cells are the very, very important part. So we have to select the right cells from the patient's body. And the next one is the scaffold. So this scaffold will provide the structural support and shape to construct. For example, you want to construct a ear. So we have to make a scaffold which is shaped like an ear, and where you can put the cells, and finally it forms the ear-like shape. And usually the scaffold should be biodegradable and biocompatible. So what is the difference between biodegradable and biocompatible? So biocompatible means it should be compatible to the biological system. And biodegradable means, so once it is degraded inside the body, so the degraded product, it should not induce any toxic effect inside the body. So that is a biodegradable property. So whenever you select the material for making the scaffold, so these two properties are very, very important. And the third one is the cell signaling. Okay, so the signals are very, very important. So for example, so when we add the cells on the scaffold, the cells don't know it has to differentiate into liver cell or it has to differentiate into kidney cells. So we have to give the cell signaling. This cell signaling is going to decide, and it is going to induce the stem cells to become like a liver cell or the kidney cell. So let us see these three in details. So as I told you, these three requirements for the tissue engineering are the cell source, and that is a scaffold, that is a ECM. We can also say it as a ECM, that is an extracellular matrix. So this ECM, and third one is the signals, that is the growth factors or the drugs. So when you talk about the cell source, So as I told earlier, we can take the embryonic stem cells or we can use the adult stem cells. So embryonic stem cells, to get the embryonic stem cells, we need the aborted fetus. So we have to take it from the embryo. So there are a lot of ethical issues. And some of the research shows that these embryonic stem cells can be a potential to become like a cancer cell. So most of the country, the research is halted. And the adult stem cells, it has compared to the embryonic stem cell, it has a less ethical. And here we are going to take the stem cells from the patient's own body. Okay, so that is the one advantage. And adult stem cells, we can take the stem cells from the patient body and we can add it on the scaffold, we can differentiate, and that can be re-implanted into the patient body. So the adult stems are widely used in most of the labs. And when we talk about the scaffolds, so these scaffolds, we can use this, or we can select the scaffold, depends on the organ which you want to grow. For example, if you want to replace the hip joint or the knee joint, so where it has to withstand more amount of weight. So when it has to withstand more amount of weight, we have to select a scaffold which is made up of metal. Or if you want to select, for example, to repair the bone damage, we can select the scaffold like made upon this ceramics. And in some cases, we have to use a synthetic polymer. For example, you want to replace the blood walls and where it should not degrade. So we have to use the synthetic polymers. And in some cases, we can use the natural polymer. For example, if you want to replace the skin, okay, suppose some person is having that skin damage due to the burn or due to the wound. So in that cases, we can use this natural polymer. So the natural polymer will degrade with respect to time. So, and the new skin will be regenerated. In that cases, we can use the natural polymer as a scaffold. And third point is that is very important, that is a signal. So that is going to decide whether your stem cell has to differentiate into liver cells or the kidney cells. For example, the stem cells are like a kind of, it's undifferentiated cells. So you don't know it has to become like a liver or a kidney cell. In a simple layman term, so you might have also seen the old movie, like the twin brothers born in a family, and when they go for a train journey, so they get separated. And one will grow in the hero family and one will grow in the villain family. So the one who grow in the hero family, he became a hero. And one who grow in the villain family, he became a villain. It is similar to that. That stem cells, it don't know. And depends on the growth factor, it depends on the environmental. So it can become like a liver cell or it can become like a kidney cell. So we can add the suitable growth factors or the drugs. So that will make the stem cell to differentiate into liver cells or the kidney cell. And the third important parameter is the mechanical force. So again, the mechanical force also plays a very, very important role in the tissue engineering. The another simple example to understand the role of mechanical force is, you might have also observed the boys who stays in the hostel, the same hostel and the same room and the same mess food, but the person who goes to gym, he get very good muscular development. Because what happens is, when you go to gym and do the exercise, the mechanical force, okay, so the mechanical signals will induce the gene expression, protein expression in the particular tissue. So due to that, he get the muscular development. Okay, so that step is called as mechanotransduction. That means mechanical force converted into chemical force. And that field is called as mechanobiology. So in our work also, we have induced this mechanical force using the magnetic nanoparticle, which I'll explain in detail later. So briefly, I'll talk about what is stem cell. So as I told you, the stem cells are undifferentiated cells. And it can become like any kind of cells. So in another simple term to understand this concept is, it is like a seed. When you put a seed in the soil, so the seed will grow into plant. And from the plant, you get the flower. And from the flower, you get the fruit. And fruit makes thousands of seeds. The same process can repeat. The same thing happens here. The stem cells are undifferentiated cells. From the stem cell, we can grow more number of stem cells, or we can add the growth factors, or we can add the signals, and the stem cells can be differentiated into the particular type. It can be liver or kidney or the heart cells based on the growth factor or the signal what we are providing to the stem cells. Okay, so the stem cells are divided into three types, totipotents. That means it can become like any kind of tissue, and multipotent. So it can be like multiple types. The another one is unipotent. That is only, it can make only like a particular type of cells. For example, each organ comes with a particular number of stem cells. For example, liver comes with liver stem cells, kidney comes with the kidney stem cells. So that stem cell can become like a only particular organ. it cannot become like any other organ. That is called as unipotent, only one type. And multipotent, it can be multiple types. And in case of the totipotent, it can become any kind of cells. Okay. So from the totipotent embryonic stem cells, we can get any kind of organ. And in the multipotent, you can get multiple types. And specialized cells, for example, liver stem cells, it can grow only like a liver cell. And next one is the scaffold. So the scaffold should be three-dimensional, as I told earlier, and it should allow the cells to attach. Okay, the cells should be able to attach on the scaffold, and it should be mostly porous in nature. So if it is porous in nature, what happens? It can allow the nutrients. Whenever we grow the cells, we add the nutrients in the form of amino acids, in the form of proteins. So the nutrients has to go inside the porous scaffold, and the cells should take the nutrients and grow nicely. And also, whatever the waste material, that should also go out of through this porous. So that's why usually the scaffold will be porous in nature, and it should encourage the cells, and it should not harm the patient. So once you have the scaffold, what you can do, you can add the cells on the scaffold, and we can regrow the complete tissue. And in the field of tissue engineering, there are several other organs which was already created in the lab. For example, skin, bone, and cartilage. These are already well established in the most of the labs. But there are some of the other organs, for example, liver, heart, and lung. So these are the organs. It has a complex metabolic functions, so it is very, very difficult to reproduce these organs in the lab. And another setback when developing these organs are the scaffold. So if you see that most of the scaffolds commercially available in the market, it is static. Okay, it is three-dimensional, but it is static. But if you see the lungs or the heart, it has to shrink and expand. Okay, so there is no such scaffold available in the market which can shrink and expand. So that's where our idea to make a scaffold which can shrink and expand with respect to the signal. And can we grow the liver cells, or can we grow the heart cells or the lung cells in the artificial lab environment, and which can mimic like your lungs, or which can mimic like the heart, and so that can improve this tissue engineering field. That's what our idea. And let us see a simple example. What is the role of the skin tissue engineering? So you might have also observed whenever, you know, childhood, whenever you've got a wound, you get this scar formation. So what happens is whenever you get a wound, you are losing this much amount of tissue. So when you are losing this much amount of tissue, the tissue in the both the sides, it tried to come close and it tried to join together. So when it joined together, what happened? So you already lost this much amount of tissue, the red color area. So due to which you get the scar formation. Okay. So the scar formation became your identification mark in your 10th certificate or JE certificate, whatever. So to avoid the scar formation, whenever you get any wound, if the wound is small, our skin can regenerate. If the wound is bigger, in case of a burn or in case of a severe accident skin wound, so it is very, very difficult to repair the damage, skin damage. In those cases, this skin tissue engineering can be very helpful. For example, if you're losing this much amount of tissue, we can replace with the artificial skin, artificial tissue, and that can regenerate the damaged skin. So in this case, you don't make any scar formation. So how to grow the skin? There are two approaches, in vitro and in vivo. In vitro means it's in the laboratory condition. In vivo means inside the living system. So in vitro, for example, you can grow the complete artificial skin and you can place it in the body. So that is the one approach. And in vivo, you can put the scaffold and you can add the cells and it can grow on the patient's body. So that way it can repair the skin damage. For example, you can see this is a mouse model where you can cut and make a wound. And when you put the active scaffold, which can enhance the cell attachment and the growth. So you can see here, it is growing scaffold. It is encouraging the cell. And it is there is no scar formation. But in case if you are putting an inactive scaffold and which is not really encourage the cells to grow, you can see here you are getting this scar formation. So this is an overall idea about the tissue engineering. And the tissue engineering is not only for the biomedical application, we can also use it for edible application. Recently, the Singapore government, they have also approved for the edible meat, that is a lab grown meat. We can grow the meat in the lab. So we don't have to grow the animals and cut the animals and take the tissue for the meat purpose. We can also grow the meat in the lab. So for example, this is a paper. It was published by some research group in the 2010 in the Nature. So from pig to plate, we can take the tissue from the pig and we can isolate the cells and we can grow the cells in the lab condition. When you grow the more number of cells, we have to apply the mechanical pressure. We have to give the mechanical signal. So as I told you in the earlier, one of the slide, so this mechanical signal is very, very important in the tissue growth and tissue formation. For example, you want to taste meat, which is taste like the chicken leg piece. So what happened that the meat should undergo that much mechanical pressure, then only it can taste like a real meat. So for that, whenever you grow the meat in the lab condition, then you have to exercise the muscle to boost the protein. Then you can add the flavors or iron or vitamins, and we can enrich the meat and it's ready to cook and eat. So the tissue engineering is not only for the biomedical application, we can also use it for the edible. So we can have the lab grown meat for the various application, for the edible applications also. So we got an overall idea about what is tissue engineering, and let us see why we have to apply nanotechnology in the tissue engineering. What is the role of nanotechnology in the tissue engineering? So before that, let us see what is nanofibers. So if you see that nanofibers is the continuous fibers, which is in the range of nanometer, and usually their size is in the range of 50 to 500 nanometer in dimension, and which is close to your ECM, that is the extracellular matrix. Okay. So in our body, all the tissues, we have this kind of nanofibrous scaffold, that is the ECM, that is the extracellular matrix. So on the top of that, you are having this micro-sized cell. And to get the idea about how much small is the nanofiber, you can see here this brown color. So this brown color is your human hair. So this human hair is 80,000 nanometer. Okay. And below that, you are having these nanofibers. So the nanofibers are very, very small, and it can mimic like your original ECM, that is the extracellular matrix. On the top of that, you can easily put the cells, and you can make the tissue, which can mimic like a original tissue. And these nanofibers have a lot of application. So in our lab also, we are working on antimicrobial wound dressing, tissue engineering, drug delivery, and also the water filtration. So which I'll discuss later in detail. So in this work, the patent work, whatever we have done, the technology transfer, mainly we focused on the tissue engineering. So we made a scaffold which can withstand the, which can overcome the drawbacks with the three-dimensional scaffold. So let us see why we use nanofibers, or what is the role of the nanotechnology in the tissue engineering. So initially, researchers used a micropore scaffold. So when they use the micropore scaffold, what happens is it has a lot of gaps. It has a micropore gaps, and your cell is also in the range of micrometer. So your cell is also in the range of micrometer, and you are having the micropore size gaps. So the cell is attaching only to the support. So there are a lot of gaps, and it does not mimic like your original tissue. And then the researchers shifted to the microfiber. So when they use the microfiber scaffold, again, if you see that the cell is in the range of micrometer and the fiber is also in the range of micrometer, the cell is growing only on the axis of the microfiber. It is not exactly growing on the tissue. So that's why we need the nanofiber scaffold. So when you have this nanofiber scaffold, so this is in the range of nanometer and your human cell is in the range of micrometer. So when you have this micrometer cell on this nanometer size scaffold, so it can exactly mimic like your original ECM, extracellular matrix, and it can exactly mimic like your original tissue. So that is the advantage of using this nanofiber. So this is a original extracellular matrix, which is made up of collagen and other protein. So this is in our body. So when we can simulate to this ECM, we can mimic in our lab condition using the various setup, which I'll discuss in later in detail. So you can see here, this is a single cell. So this is a scanning ultrasound microscope picture of a single cell. So this is a single cell. It is attaching to the thousands of nanofibers. When a single cell attached to thousands of nanofibers, so the transmission of fine signals are possible. Then it can exactly mimic like your original tissue. That is the overall idea of tissue engineering. So how to make these nanofibers? There are three methods to make these nanofibers: self-assembly, phase separation, and ultraspinning. So I'll briefly discuss about these techniques. So self-assembly is, the word itself has a meaning. It assembles on its own. We don't have to do anything. So when you have this hydrophilic, that means hydrophilic means water loving. So when you have the hydrophilic amino acid as a head and hydrophobic amino acid as a tail. For example, whenever we put a drop of oil in the water, it always forms this kind of like a spherical, circle-like structure. That is the micellar formation. Okay, it don't form the square or it won't form the triangle shape. So why it is forming this circular shape, the micellar structure? Because it has a hydrophilic head. The hydrophilic head moved towards the water, and this hydrophobic tail, it tried to escape from the water. Okay, so that's why it forms the spherical structure. So we can take the idea from the nature, and we can do the self-assembly process where you can use the protein. Okay, so when you have the hydrophilic amino acid as a head and hydrophobic amino acid as a tail, so when you have this as a tail and when you put it into water, it will assemble and it forms like a three-dimensional scaffold. So it forms like a three-dimensional scaffold, and which can mimic like your extracellular matrix, and where we can grow the cells and we can use it for growing the artificial tissue. And the next technique is the phase separation. So in the phase separation, you'll be separating a different phase, liquid-liquid or the solid-liquid phase. So here you'll be dissolving the polymer into the solvent, and when you heat it, so you'll get the solution. And when you heat it at a particular temperature, and at the particular temperature, you'll get two regions, that is the polymer-rich and polymer-poor region. So, and at that temperature, we can stop the reaction and you can do the freeze drying. Freeze drying means that you'll be reducing the temperature and cooling and drying it. So when you dry it, so it will dry it and form this kind of porous scaffold. So that is called as phase separation. So we can get the different kind of porous scaffold using this phase separation method. There is another technique called salt leaching method. So the salt leaching method is whenever you have the polymer, you'll be adding the salt. And once the polymer is saltified, you can dissolve the salt. When you dissolve the salt, what will happen? There will be a porous, you'll get the porous structure. It is similar to, for example, if you have the chocolate chip cookies, when you remove those chocolate chips, so you'll get the cookies with the porous structure. The same thing, whenever you have the polymer, whenever you add the salt, and once the polymer is saltified, when you dissolve the salt, you get this kind of porous scaffold where you can add the cells and it can grow and it can make like original tissue. And the third technique, the electrospinning techniques, most of the lab use these techniques because it is a very simple method. Even in our lab also, we have used these techniques to develop the four-dimensional scaffold. So it is a very, very simple technique. And using that technique, we can easily make the nanofibers. So if you see the principle of this electrospinning technique, so the simple layman example to understand this principle of the electrospinning technique is the cotton candy machine. So you might have also seen in the exhibition or most of the shows, like the principle of electrospinning is similar to the cotton candy machine. So here you'll be adding the polymer. So if you see that the person, the cotton candy vendor, he used to add the polymer. So what polymer he adds? He adds the sugar. The sugar is the polymer. So when you add the sugar will melt. And you might have also observed whenever you touch any sweets like gulab jamun or rasgulla, so you get some kind of thread-like structure, right? Whenever you touch the sweet. So that viscous nature is very, very important. Whenever you put the sugar here, the sugar will melt, and due to the high electric potential, what will happen? This sugar polymer will be spun out through these tiny holes. So when it comes out through the tiny holes, it forms like a fibrous structure, and this fibrous structure will be collected by the vendor with the using a small collector. We use the stick and he collect all the fibers. It's basically what we are eating is micro-sized fiber, microfiber we are eating. The sugar candy, that cotton candy, is a microfiber we are eating it. Okay, so we can make this scaffold similar to that using this electrospinning setup. So in the electrospinning setup, instead of sugar, we'll be adding the biodegradable or biocompatible polymer, that is a FDA approved polymer. We can load it into the syringe and we can apply the high voltage. So when you apply the high voltage, what happens? Due to this electrostatic potential, this due to accumulation of high charge, so this polymers, it form like a cone shape. So that is called a Taylor cone. So once it forms the cone shape, then it will lose out the fibers, and that fibers can be collected in the grounded collector. So this is a static collector. So the distance between the syringe and the collector is very, very important. So when you have the optimized distance, you get the nanofiber. Okay. And if you're keeping the collector close to the needle, then you get the micro-sized fiber. So the distance between the needle and the collector is very important, and also the viscosity of the solution also very, very important. So, and this is a stationary collector. There's one more collector called a rotating drum collector. So we used a rotating drum collector to make our aligned nanofibers. So this rotating drum collector, what happens? These fibers will be coiled around the rotating drum. It is like your thread bundles, which we used to play the kite. So when you use the rotating drum collector, you get this kind of aligned fibers. So you can see here, the fibers are aligned when you use the rotating drum collector. And when we use the stationary collector, so when you use this kind of stationary collector, so you get this kind of random fibers. Okay. So depends on the application, you can use the rotating drum collector or you can use the stationary collector and you can get the random fibers. So by this, you got an overall idea about what is tissue engineering and what is the role of nanotechnology in tissue engineering. And now I'll explain about how we use this ultraspinning and how we made this four-dimensional scaffold as well as the tissue engineering apparatus and to overcome the drawbacks with the existing three-dimensional scaffold. So as I told earlier, so we usually grow the cells in the petri dish or the glass plate, so which is two-dimensional, so which is not going to mimic your body condition. So to overcome that, we have to use the three-dimensional scaffold. But when you use the three-dimensional scaffold, again, this three-dimensional scaffold is static. It is not dynamic. So to overcome that, we have to use the animal model. But animal models are expensive and time-consuming. So can we have something in between the animal model and which is better than the three-dimensional scaffold? So that's what our idea. So that's why we made this four-dimensional scaffold, which is alternative, or I can say that it is a little bit better than the three-dimensional cell culture. And again, it cannot replace completely the animal studies. The animal studies are the more close to the human studies. So when you have this three-dimensional scaffold, so we see that mostly, as I told earlier, the heart cells and the lung cells, which need the scaffold, which can shrink and expand, so that can mimic like a original condition. So that's what our idea, to make the scaffold. So in order to bridge this gap, so we fabricated the multi-layered nanofiber scaffold. So these are the multi-layered scaffold. So in this scaffold, in the both the sides, we added the magnetic nanoparticle. So in the both the sides, we added the magnetic nanoparticles. And in the middle, so it is having this gelatin and collagen, which can enhance the cell attachment. So in the middle portion, we can add the cells. And both the sides, we added the magnetic nanoparticle. So when you add the magnetic nanoparticle, when you apply this kind of this external magnetic field, so when you have this external magnetic field and the scaffold is inside the cell culture medium, and when you apply the magnetic field, the scaffold can shrink and expand. So the scaffold can shrink and expand, and that will give the mechanical stimuli to these cells. So here you are having this magnet and the cells are in the middle. When you give this mechanical signal using this magnet, and the scaffold can shrink and expand. So we can have the desired rate of motion using that magnetic field, or we can have also we can increase or reduce the magnetic field, depends on the load, how much we are loading the magnetic nanoparticles in the scaffold. Okay. And here, when you have this DC powered motor, then it can easily move, it can go to and fro. And when it goes to and fro, the middle portion where your cells are loaded, so it will undergo the mechanical stress. It is like you are giving the artificial exercise to the cells, and it can mimic, or it can be, we can say it is a, instead of a static three-dimensional scaffold, it is a dynamic scaffold. So when you give this mechanical force, what happens is the cells are aligned and reoriented, and it is growing on in one particular direction. So based on the force, so as I told you the previously some example, like the person who goes to gym, you get the muscular development. Similarly, whenever you stimulate the cells with the mechanical forces or using the magnetic field, the cells are reorganizing and it's aligning in the same direction, and it's regrowing in the direction where you are giving the magnetic field. And what is happening is the cell is having these lot of the cytoskeletal filaments. Cytoskeletal means it is like a foundation of the cell. Okay, so it has the G actin. So the G actin is a monomer, and these are the F actin. So these are like the this Lego bricks. So using this Lego bricks, you can construct the building or you can construct a car. Okay. So similarly, these G actins are like Lego bricks. So in the cell, normally this is available in the monomer as well as it is also available in the polymer, this actins. So the actins are very, very important for the cells. Okay. So for example, you are getting a signal. For example, if there is a nutrient in this site, so what will happen? The cell will move towards the nutrient. So to move towards the nutrients, the cell has to rearrange its actin. So what happens is, so this will disassemble all the F actin and it become like a G actin monomer, and it will assemble on the other direction. Okay, it is like removing the tent from one side and putting the tent on the other side. So wherever the nutrients are there, so it will move in the particular direction where the nutrients are there. So same force is very, very important. Whenever we give this magnetic field and induce the cells, due to the mechanical force, you can see here that it is triggering the upregulation of cytoskeletal and focal adhesion proteins. So it is inducing the protein expression. Basically, the cytoskeletal protein expression it is inducing. And what happens is, whenever you give the mechanical stress, the stress fiber is increased. Okay, so that we observed whenever you use the cells, and whenever you give the cells stress to these cells, so the stress fibers are increased. And this filopodium are the finger-like structures. The cell is also having a finger-like structure. The cell will attach to the support. For example, this is your support. The cell will use like a finger-like structure and it will attach on the support. The cell which has a finger-like structure, that is called as filopodium. So using that, it is attaching, and it using that filopodium, it will move in the particular direction. Okay. So whenever you give the mechanical signal, you can see here, this is a not stimulated one. No mechanical signal, and when you give the mechanical signal, you can see here the stress fibers, it is increased more. Okay, the stress fibers, it is increased more, similar to this. So depends on the stress fibers are increased more. And as I told, you can also see here the G-actin protein. The G-actin, this is a monomer. So the monomer is assembling and form this F-actin. So F-actin is like a rope-like structure, and this G-actin is a monomer subunits. So this monomer will join like a beads, and it forms like this kind of F-actin, like a polymer, like a thread-like structure. And you can also see here, this is a filopodium. So filopodium is like a finger-like structures, which will hold and grab it. Okay, grab the scaffold. So when we give the mechanical stimuli or signal to this scaffold, so it is like a child holding the mom or sister. Okay, when we go in the roller coaster. So you can see here, we use the aligned nanofiber. These are the aligned nanofiber. So whenever you give the mechanical signal, to withstand that mechanical signal and mechanical force, the cell is grabbing. The cell is grabbing the nanofibers. Okay. So how much it is able to grab? You can see here, this is 5 to 10 micrometer displacement. So this is a 5 to 10 micrometer displacement. It is able to grab all the nanofibers. So these are the aligned nanofibers, but all the aligned nanofibers, this cell, it is grabbed with respect to the mechanical signal. So using that, we can understand how the mechanical force plays an important role in the cell growth and cell signaling. So that's why this scaffold will be more important, who are working in the mechanobiology, and also who want to mimic the exact conditions like a lung or the heart exposed. And how big is the market? The market for the three-dimensional scaffold is keep on increasing. And that's why like we want to have this scaffold, which is better than the three-dimensional scaffold. So as I told you, we can also use our scaffold as a simple three-dimensional scaffold. And if you want to use it as a four-dimensional, you can give the mechanical force by using the external magnet. So it can solve the both the purpose. It can act as a three-dimensional, and also it can act as a four-dimensional scaffold. So the commercial aspect of our technology is like it is a improved alternative for our three-dimensional cell culture, and it's very, very low cost when compared to the commercially available three-dimensional scaffold. And minimal intervention is required because we are going to use the external magnet, and it's highly versatile. We can easily use it by simply changing the magnetic field, and we can alter the cycles and frequency. And again, this complete device is made up of a simple transparent plastic. So we can easily use it under any microscope, and it won't interfere. That is another advantage of using this device, which we made in our lab. And if you see the cost comparison, these are the three-dimensional scaffold. Our scaffold is four-dimensional still. So these are the three-dimensional scaffold. You can see the cost of the three-dimensional scaffold. And our scaffold is less than 50 rupees. So which is 100 or 200 times less than the existing commercially available three-dimensional scaffold. So that is the advantage of our scaffold. And the unique and innovative aspects are like, as I told earlier, so whenever you give this mechanical signal, the cells will reorganize and arrange and grow in the particular direction. So which is important when you want to understand the mechanical signal, and also it will be important for understanding the cancer mechanobiology. So whenever you have the cancer and you want to know that how the cancer spreads from one location to another location, the cancer metastasis process, that can be also using this kind of scaffold, we can study that. And it is also giving the better correlation between the in vitro and in vivo. So when compared to the animal study and when compared to the three-dimensional study, it is in between. It is giving a better than the three-dimensional results. And whenever you grow the cells, heart cells or the lung cells in this kind of scaffold, which is mimicking like a original tissue, so it will reduce the incompliance with the host physiological condition. So that is another advantage of this scaffold. And again, we can also use the stem cells. As I told in one of the slides, for making the stem cells to differentiate, we have to add the growth factors or some kind of chemicals. So by using this scaffold, we don't have to add any kind of growth factors. We can give the mechanical signal and we can make the stem cells to differentiate. So that is also possible using this kind of scaffold and device. And again, the apparatus and device, the scaffold is versatile and it's very compact in nature. So we can keep the complete setup into the cell culture incubator. Okay, so you don't have to purchase any other accessories. You can keep the complete device into the CO2 incubator. And also we can, the complete device can easily fit into any standard microscope, cell culture microscope. So that is the advantage of this device. And as I told you, this is a transparent one. So we can easily monitor the cell growth and the cell movement and everything. And that is the advantage of this device and scaffold. And for this work, we have filed a patent and we have done the technology transfer to SAR group of company. And we are still developing the device design. So these designs are not professional. So we are discussing with the company and we are making it more professional and user-friendly. And the process is still going on. And also there are some drawback in the scaffold, like we want to improve that scaffold more user-friendly. And that's why we developed this project and we modified and we submitted. And for this work, we got this Bhairag Gandhi Young Innovation Technology Innovation Award. And the DPT supported this project for 15 lakh rupees and to develop the commercially, like a commercial scale product. So we are in the process. We are making it the commercial product, the collaboration with the company. And mainly Dr. Uday Kumar, he developed this device and the work is continued by Mr. Vinay Kumar. So he's currently pursuing and he's extending this work and he's making the more user-friendly scaffold. And also this work was published in the ASA channel. It was also selected by the editor for the cover page of the issue. And this is a work what we have done. And I'll be brief going through the some of the other work, other products which we made in our lab using these nanofibers. So we also made the core and shell nanofibers for the drug delivery. So here the core and shell means it is like a pin and refill. Okay, so when you make the core and shell, so inside the core you can load one type of anti-cancer drug and the shell you can load another type of anti-cancer drug. So when you have the core and shell and when you do the cross-linking, so we can control the release of the anti-cancer drug. For example, this is cross-link and this is also cross-linked. So here the drugs will be released slow. And here it is not cross-linked, and here it is cross-linked. So we can control the release of drug by simple cross-linking reaction. And this will be the final product. You can see here, this is the final product, anti-cancer drug loaded nanofibers. So the main application of this product is like, for example, whenever the patients with the breast cancer undergo the surgery to remove the breast tumor. So when they remove the tumor, when they remove the tumor, the main drawback with the tumor is like if they not completely remove the tumor, there's a high chance for the reoccurrence of tumor. So to prevent that, they can use this kind of bio bandage. So this is a anti-cancer drug loaded bio bandage, and this bio bandage will release the anti-cancer drug slowly, and it will prevent the reoccurrence of the cancer cell. And you can see here, this is a these are the nanofibers, the small thread-like structure. These are the nanofibers, and these are the cells. Okay. So whenever the cells, whenever the cells undergo apoptosis, there is a cell death. So that from the nanofiber, the anti-cancer drug is releasing. So when the drugs are released, the cells which are like a spindle shape, so it will become like rounded. Okay, it become like rounded. That means the cell is undergoing the cell death process. Okay. And the next work, what we did is we also made a bio bandage using the biopolymer, that is a silk, and this polymer is using that biocompatible polymer, it is increasing the, like, it has a very good antibacterial efficiency, and also it is having a rapid wound healing property and scarless wound healing. So by using this biobandage, you don't get any scar formation. So you can see here, when you use the mouse model and we made the wound, and when you put the commercially available bandage and our biobandage, and we can put it on the top of that, and you can see here, when you put our biobandage, and the healing is faster, and it is able to heal the wound in a shorter duration of time, and it is able to completely heal without any scar formation. That is the advantage of this biobandage. And recently we have filed a patent, and one international company and one Indian company has approached us for the technology transfer. The negotiation is going on. And another product what we made is this work was done by one of our MSc postdoc student, and he developed this cell culture insert. So most of the cell culture lab, we use the cell culture insert to understand the cell migration, how the cells move, and also how the wound is healing. So to understand the wound healing, so we need the artificial environment. So for that, we need the, we use the commercially available cell culture insert. The commercially available cell culture insert is, again, it's expensive. So we use a simple silk, and we use the tips, which is a waste tips. We can simply take and cut the tips and autoclave, and you can deposit the nanofiber, and which can act like a cell culture insert, which will be useful for understanding the cell migration and other application. So for this also, we have recently filed a patent. And not only for the biomedical application, we can also use this nanofibers for various environmental application also. So we have made the nanofiber based low cost water filter. So here you can see here, this is a, in this nanofiber, we added a nanomaterial which can kill the bacteria. And we have also added another nanomaterial which can adsorb all the heavy metals. So it can remove the heavy metals, and also it can remove the bacteria. So we have used here GFP expressing E. coli bacteria, okay, green fluorescent protein expressing E. coli bacteria, so that we can easily monitor the bacterial filtration efficiency. So you can see here, this is a bacterial solution. This bacterial solution is highly turbid. It is a more than 10 power 6 or 10 power 7 bacterial population, CFU, colony forming units. And when we add the turbid bacterial solution, and when we put our nanofiber membrane here, and without any electricity or without any physical pressure or vacuum pump, so it automatically filters by the simple filtration process. Okay, and you can see here there is a zero bacteria, so no bacteria. It's completely filtered, and we have also studied in the colony forming unit, the plate assay, and there is no colony formation. So it is completely bacteria free, and it's a very very low cost. And I want to develop this technology also into the which can be useful for the village person, common person, like it will be like a kind of a nanofiber sheet which we can put it on the top of the pot and fill the water, so that can remove the heavy metals and that can remove the bacteria, which will be useful for people who's in the village and where there is no electricity. So here you don't need any electricity. That is the advantage of this technology. And also recently we have developed the nanofiber based mask. Okay, so this nanofiber based mask, and it is able to filter even the nanometer range. So that's what we proposed, this nanofiber based mask. And the commercially available mask is a three layer, and our nanofiber based mask is kind of a six layer. And again, it can filter even the virus, and also it can also, it has a material, it won't allow the bacteria to grow, and again there won't be any odor. Okay, we can use it for the normal air pollution also. So it has a multiple application, and whenever you put a N95 mask, you may face some kind of suffocation, but this nanofiber based mask is highly compatible with your face, and you don't feel any suffocation. So this mask also, we have filed a patent, and again, we are about to do the technology transfer, like still the process going on. So we are strapped with the equipment. So the commercially mask making, the nanofiber making machine, which is not available in India. So that's why we are stuck in the process. Hopefully soon this product will also be available, commercially available. So that's all for the lecture, and I thank all my students, research group in the nanobiotechnical lab, and also all my funding agency. So my students are the full pillars of this, all this research work, and all the research work done by my students, and also I thank all the funding agency who supported our work. thank you all. If you have any other questions, I'll be happy to answer the questions.
Thank you, Professor Gopinath, for such an amazing lecture. The lecture is very insightful and very informative. So I request the audience, if you have any question, please do type in the chat box. So I will read on behalf of you, and Professor Gopinath will answer. So I have one small question.
Yes.
When you have this artificial meat and we are producing this using the, you know, artificial environment. So
okay.
How cost effective is this compared to a animal which eats all grass or something waste material, like which also uses the environmental cycling? So in compared to this, how beneficial is of making this artificial meat or so?
Yeah, so the commercial, when you have the commercial meat, when you initially, that as I told, it's really expensive, but when you make it commercially, the scaffold in the large scale, the meat cost will go down. And again, when you have the animals, we have to, there are a lot of maintenance for the animals. If the animals get sick, the whole things will be, has to be, we have to destroy the whole farm. And again, this animals also have a, we have to put the proper vaccination, and we have to maintain, and also it's not eco-friendly. There are a lot of challenges when you cut the animals, and it will also create a lot of further pollutions. So those things can be overcome by using this kind of artificial meat. So that's why the recently the Singapore government also approved for making this artificial meat in the lab, and which is really less expensive when compared to the original meat.
Okay, so we have one question in the chat box. What would be the impact of scaffold stiffness on cellular development?
Yeah, the scaffold thickness on cell development. Yeah, stiffness. The scaffold thickness is also a very important parameter.
It's the, so it's, it not thickness, on, it's the stiffness.
Stiffness, okay, yes. Okay. Yeah, the scaffold stiffness is very important, because that I told in the one of the slide also. So the scaffold stiffness is not that much, and it cannot withstand the mechanical pressure. So in between the experiment, there's a chance that scaffold may get damaged. So that's why to overcome that, we are also further continuing with the scaffold. Along with the nanofiber, we want to have the gel-like matrix. So when you have the gel-like matrix along with the nanofiber, which can exactly mimic like your original tissue, and that can withstand the pressure. So that work is, we are continuing that work.
Okay, so we have one more question. So you talked about the water filter and the bacterial thing. So what is the,
yes,
filter working principle? What is the principle behind this filter which you showed?
Just the only the physical one, that is when you add the water, it's like a normal tea filter. There is no vacuum pump or anything. So we can also use the vacuum pump, which can easily create the pressure, and it can easily filter, and it can fast up the process. But in other ways also, you can use it without the power supply. We can simply add the water, and which can filter it like a normal, like a tea filter kind of thing. It is mainly for the portable water filter, which can be useful where there is no electricity. So that's what our idea, and zero wastage of water.
So, and what is any idea about the pore size of the filter?
The pore size in the range of nanometer, so which can filter the bacteria, and also it has another material which can absorb all the heavy metals.
Yeah, so, and one more question is, in the six-layered mask, what you are proposing,
yeah.
So,
right.
Can you name the raw materials? Someone is asking if, since it is a patented work or something.
Yeah, we use it. Two different combination of polymers, and also we use also two different types of nanomaterial. So one material will take care of antibacterial efficiency, the other material will take care of absorbing the smoke. If you are mainly the Delhi pollution, you have the smoke. So that another material will absorb all the smoke, and another material will take care of the killing the bacteria. And the nanofiber, which is in the range of nanometer, So it can even prevent the entry of the virus or the other nano-sized particles. So
okay,
that is the advantage of this nanofiber mask.
So one more question on the filtration. So can it filter the viruses?
Yeah, it can filter the virus. As I told, like this nanofiber, it is as such we can use as a mask, or we can have the commercial mask. Our idea is the commercially there are some low cost masks are available, like the green color mask, surgical mask, which is 5 rupees or 10 rupees. And if you see that, open it, there'll be a space in the middle. So where you can put our nanofiber, and it can easily filter the virus also. And as I told, these are in the range of nanometer dimension, so it can easily filter the virus also.
Okay. So in the scaffolds which you have used, did you use any heavy metal based scaffolds?
No, heavy metal we didn't use at the scaffold. For
okay.
That.
So in the same line, so the in vitro scaffold for tissue engineering, how do you provide the blood vessels and nerves?
Yeah, so the blood vessels and nerves, that is a challenge. So here, as I told, this is not the complete organ. It is a one step between the in vivo and the one step ahead of the three-dimensional cell culture. For making the blood vessels, we have to go for the organ printing. So that's why recently we purchased a machine through the, along with Professor Devarpal Agri, through the SMILE project, 3D bioprinting machine. So once it is functional, then we can make the artificial organ and artificial tissue with the blood veins and blood vessels. So that is a major challenge in the tissue engineering.
So one more question is, how can we make these scaffolds more dynamic?
The scaffold can be more dynamic as it, we can add the magnetic nanoparticle in the sides. We can optimize the concentration or the amount of magnetic nanoparticles in the sides. And also we can control the magnetic field. Using that, we can also control the efficiency of the scaffold.
Okay. So thanks, Professor Gopinath. So there we end the question and answer session. So with this, we complete the presentation. So now I request Professor B.R. Gujje, Dean Alumni Affairs, for the citation of Professor P. Gopinath. Sir, please.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Paluri. So as you know, this is VNMM Award ceremony, that is Virendranath Malti Mittal Award ceremony. And this is supported by Virendranath Malti Mittal Trust. And this is, you know, very prestigious award, which is given to those who generate some technology which is commercially viable and patented and has, you know, wide applications. So that is the idea about this award. And now I take this opportunity to read the citation of today's awardee, Professor P. Gopinath. Dr. P. Gopinath completed his graduation in microbiology and master's in biotechnology from Srimad Andhavan Arts Science College, Bharati Southern University, Trichy. He obtained his PhD in biotechnology from IIT Guwahati, and he is at present working as associate professor in the Department of Biotechnology at IIT Roorkee. Dr. Gopinath has been selected for this award for a technology patented by his group that provides a hybrid multi-layered nanofibrous scaffold and a four-dimensional dynamic cell culture apparatus. The pre-existing 3D scaffolds in the market do not address the dynamic culture conditions covered in this technology, and thus do not represent the in vivo conditions as closely as the 4D scaffold proposed in this invention. Furthermore, the scaffold is biocompatible, operates in non-contact mode, and is precisely controlled across all the three dimensions. The scaffold serves as a realistic and relevant platform for studying the role of cytoskeleton proteins and focal adhesion proteins in various diseases. Dr. Gopinath has received several recognitions, including Sri Om Prakash Sharma Young Scientist Award for outstanding contributions in biomedical research by the Indian Academy of Biomedical Sciences, the G.D. Naidu Young Scientist Award, the Institute Research Fellowship of IIT Roorkee for Outstanding Young Faculty, and Professor H.S. Srivastav Foundation Young Scientist Award. Recently, his research team has received the prestigious Virag Srishti Gandhian Young Technological Innovation for 2019 Award from Sri M. Venkesh Naidu, Honorable Vice President of India at Vigyan Bhavan, New Delhi. It is a pleasure and privilege for the Indian Institute of Technology Roorkee to honor Dr. P. Gopinath with the Virendranath Malti Mittal Award for the year 2018. Now I request our director, Professor Ajit Kumar Chaturvedi, to please give this award in virtual mode to Dr. Gopinath. Now I request Dr. Gopinath to kindly deliver his acceptance speech. Dr. Gopinath, please.
Thank you very much for all the dignitaries and also the selection committee members for considering our work and selecting for this our prestigious award. And it will be really boosting our research group. So, and also I thank all my I use this opportunity to thank my all my students who have done the day and night work and made our lab successful for the past 10 years. And also I take this opportunity to thank my PhD supervisor, Professor Ghosh in IIT Guwahati. And also I thank my parents and my family members for their kind support. And I thank, once again, I thank all the jury members and selection committee and considering our work for this award. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Gopinath. Now I request Professor A.K. Chaturvedi to please deliver the address on this very important occasion. Professor Chaturvedi, please.
Today evening's awardee, Professor Gopinath, Professor B.R. Gurjar, Dean of Resources and Alumni Affairs, Professor A.K. Sharma, Head Biotechnology, Professor Krishnamohan Poluri, the convener of today's function event, and all the attendees. I can see attendees from multiple departments, students, faculty members. A lot of people have joined today evening. We are very happy that finally this day has come. It was initially planned in the month of March, but because of the pandemic, I think everything got delayed. And finally, we are happy that this important lecture and the award ceremony has been possible today. These research awards of IIT Roorkee, they have gone a reincarnation in some sense ever since they became online. And also the amount of attention that they are getting in the academic world has made them more competitive than before. And of course, now added conditions are there that they will can be given on any day of the year. It has to be a public event, but that event has to be preceded by a public lecture by the awardee. So this was an important condition that the Institute imposed to all the IIT Roorkee Research Awards. So that when the pandemic subsides, at least the awardees can visit the campus, spend a couple of days in the institute, spend time with the colleagues who work in their areas, visit their labs, interact with them. And both it may be opportunity for both sides to learn from each other and also our institute's opportunity to showcase what we can do. Of course, in this case, it's a very special moment because the awardee is our own colleague. The awardee is from IIT Roorkee only. So that means that he's part of us. We all know him very well. In fact, we are proud of him that he could win this national award. And this research award ceremony is, of course, conducted by the Dean Alumni Office. And I think it has got a new shine and luster now with the way it is being conducted. And I hope that it becomes more and more competitive in the years to come. Because of the way now online activities afford an opportunity for wider dissemination and reach out. Outreach has increased. So I also hope that the pandemic subsides and future awardees are able to actually visit the institute, because then it will become more meaningful. With these words, I would like to conclude and congratulate again Professor Gopinath on this wonderful achievement. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Chaturvedi. Now I request Professor Poluri, please deliver the vote of thanks. Professor Paluri, you are muted.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Yeah.
So, thank you, sir. I sincerely thank our Honorable Director, Professor A.K. Chaturvedi, for gracing this auspicious VNMM award ceremony and presenting virtually the award to Professor Gopinath, the winner of VNMM award for 2018. And also thank Professor Gopinath for delivering the amazing lecture on 4D scaffolds. And I sincerely express our gratitude to the VNMM Trust for sponsoring this award through IIT Roorkee. I would like to thank Professor A.K. Sharma, Head of Department Biotechnology, and Professor B.R. Gujar, Dean Alumni Affairs, for organizing and hosting the event on behalf of IIT Roorkee. I thank all the participants for their enthusiastic participation and attending VNMM 2018 lecture. Thank you all for your kind participation. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thank you, and congratulations to Professor Gopinath.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Congratulations. Thank you all. We will close the session. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.